And now, authors, writers, books, and beyond.
Hello, welcome back to our second show this year of Authors, Writers, Books, and Beyond. My name is Kathy Boyd-Fuller, and I'm your hostess. And I have three wonderful guests I'm really excited for you to meet today. I have on my right here Kelly Gwynn, lovely author from Placerville.
From Placerville.
And Patrick Craig came all the way from Napa. I'm really thrilled that you came that distance. Thank you, Patrick.
Very well.
It was a drive, huh?
It was fun, though.
Yeah.
It opened up and was pretty cool.
Oh, good. And then we have Marcia Brim. Mm-hmm. That came from El Dorado Hills.
Actually, Camino.
Camino, okay. And let me see. I want to start off today letting you know that we're going to be sharing about the Mount Hermon Christian Writers Conference that meets down near the Santa Cruz Mountains in Mount Hermon. And that conference begins the early tracks March 20th next month and goes to the 26th. And the regular conference, I believe, starts on the 22nd. 5-day wonderful conference. We have all attended, and I would like to have my guests share the special portion that really made a difference for them in their writing life. And I'm going to start with Kelly.
Well, Mount Hermon is just, it's an amazing place to go to for starters. I knew that, but I didn't know what to expect when I got there. I'd gone to a small writers conference with maybe 100 people. Then I got there that year and there were 450. I had a few fangirl moments as I saw, you know, some of the big name authors around. Walked up to Sally Stewart of the Sally Stewart Market Guide and held out my hand and said, "You're Sally Stewart," as if she didn't know that. But the quality of the workshops was phenomenal. The instructors that we had, it was amazing. And then they're so accessible. Yeah. These writers who have big name books out there, they're there and they're there for us and they want to help us. It was a really great experience.
What was your first year there?
I believe it was 2008.
2008, I was there that year.
Oh.
Didn't know we were there.
We may have seen each other.
And Patrick, what about you?
Well, I went first in 2007. I had a friend, Barbara Curtis, who's an old friend of ours, and she passed away this last year, but a tremendous writer, wrote books on homeschooling and raising kids. They had like 12 kids, and it was just a fabulous family story. But Barbara encouraged me to go. And I went for 2 or 3 years and just kind of got the feel of it. Of course, the first year was really frantic trying to figure out how do I get to meet these guys and pitch my stories. And I had some children's stories that I was sharing then. I think one of the first ones, person that I met was Nick Harrison from Harvest House, who is now my editor.
And
and that was all part of the process. But just 2 years ago, I took a major morning track with K. Marshall Strom and just turned my spiritual life around, the whole perspective about writing from the Spirit, letting the Lord lead you in your writing. And she's such a lovely, wonderful person anyway. And I became best friends with her husband, Dan. So just the people that you meet there are just lifelong friends.
Yeah.
And the connections that you make are fabulous.
And what about you, Marcia?
Well, I really went to Mount Hermon the first time because of Kelly. she recommended that I go, and we have a small publishing company for homeschooling materials, so I have been writing for a number of years, but it was the first time where I had an adult book, which I was, I thought I would go to try to connect with agents or publishers, of which I did, which was really wonderful. I had a number of wonderful experiences there of people who asked me to submit my proposal and all of that, and that was very exciting. But really what I realized after that experience was that there was so much of the craft that I still needed to learn. It's when you're writing a teaching guide for children, that's a much different endeavor than the type of work that I'm doing right now. And that year, it was fantastic. I ordered the complete CDs from that set because I just realized how much I had to learn. And it's really interesting because of all the tapes. It was 2010 when I went, and Angela Hunt was there that year. And even though I went through I went through an intensive with Kay Marshall, the morning intensive mm-hmm. with her, which was fantastic. But of all the speakers that were there that year, I listened to Angela Hunt's tapes, and she teaches you how to write fiction, and I don't mm-hmm. write fiction. But there was actually a piece out of her lecture series that she did that I've actually incorporated into a book for adults, which is a nonfiction book that has nothing to do with the type of material that she was, you know, teaching there. But it turned out to be so amazingly applicable yeah. to what I'm writing. So just in terms of the craft, it was an incredible yeah. experience.
They offer, I think they meet both the beginning, intermediate, yeah. and mm-hmm. advanced mm-hmm. writer mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. author. Already published author, mm-hmm. and we all obviously just hone your craft there as a gold mine. Yeah. It's a gift.
That's putting it mildly. Mm-hmm. It's fabulous.
It's like almost like you leave and you felt your cup overfloweth.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I'd like to ask you guys. I have my own experience. My first year was the early 90s. Jerry Jenkins wow. was yeah. The keynote speaker pre Left Behind.
Wow.
Yeah, and I went through CBS, Community Bible Study, and that's who sent me there. It was a interesting year in that I loved the fellowship, the prayer mm-hmm. support, someone will stop alongside of you and pray with you if you need prayer. Mm-hmm. And that is, we do. Mm-hmm. It's very intense. It's wonderful and lovely, but it's also very intense. You're exhausted mm-hmm. when you go home.
Absolutely.
What would you like to share a little bit about your book, how your book came about there?
Well, this book is a direct product of my time at Mount Hermon. When I left there in 2010, I still didn't have a project. I hadn't sold anything. But later in November, I read Nick Harrison's blog, and he wrote a blog about 12 ways to aspiring author can advance his career or something. And then at the end of it, he put a little note in and he said, just to put my money where my mouth is, I'm opening a window from January 1st to January 31st. And if you have an idea for a story, send it to me. And by the way, I like Amish stories and I like quilting stories. Well, I had a friend who once said that he played in a band that always kind of missed the boat, and he said, when the opportunity knocked, we always answered the phone. And so I decided I am not going to be the guy who answers the phone. I'm going to go to the door. And so I said, okay, Nick, here's an idea for an Amish quilting story. Well, I was totally unencumbered by any previous knowledge of quilting or Amish. But he liked the story, and he said, keep going. So I kept going. He said, send me some sample chapters. So I wrote some sample chapters thinking that it was going to be a short story. And then I sent them. One of the things that you can do at Mount Hermon that's so valuable is that the staff yeah. allows you to send your material for critique.
Yes.
I sent my material to Steve Lauby, who's an agent, a very well-known agent, and he sat down with me when I got to the conference and said, you need to make this into a novel.
Wow.
And you need to write two more after that. So I went home.
Dream.
And I said, okay. And I gave myself a goal, two chapters a week. And I finished it in August. Mm. And I sent it to Steve. And he said, I want to be your agent. And then we sent it to Harvest House. And they said, it's a yes. And here we are 2 years later with A Quilt for Jenna.
And it's a beautiful cover, too.
Mm-hmm. I love the work. The company has been so supportive. Harvest House Publishers, just wonderful group of folks. Mm-hmm. And so I'm excited.
Yeah, you yeah. should be, too. What a blessing. I was in a class with Patrick last year. We took the James Scott Bell mentoring class, mm-hmm. my first mentoring class.
Yeah,
And you brought a portion of this.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just a wonderful gift to be able to work on it. We send our work in ahead mm-hmm. and worked on it when we came as a group. So that is another advantage, I think, to, yeah. I don't know how valuable you felt the input from that class was.
It was really good, really terrific. And then just the stuff I learned from Jim Bell was
oh, yeah.
guy's a monster.
He really is, in a good way.
In a good way. He kept telling me I should write Amish zombie stories.
That came up a lot.
Maybe that's the next one.
Maybe that's the next one.
Wouldn't that be something?
He's so fun and so knowledgeable.
He is very knowledgeable and so generous. That's another thing there. They are generous with their time, their patience, and very mentoring, not even just in the mentoring class, but also I think I was a little, you know, Jim Bell to me was such a big, powerful name. Mm-hmm. And to be in the class was a privilege to push myself.
Right.
I don't know if you felt
there were some great stories being told in that class.
Really good.
The folks were just, all of them, everybody was a great writer, I thought.
Well, we're going to wind down for a little bit. And when we come back, I'm going to ask Marcia and Kelly if they will share, Marcia, about your book you're working on, right? The 40 Days of Prayer and Fasting for the Ill.
Okay.
And then Kelly has a book to share too, and we'll be sharing a lot of other things with you. There's some people we all want to talk about that have made Mount Hermon a big difference. Mm-hmm. This is their 44th year for the Writers Conference there. And we lost two very wonderful people last year with Ethel and Barbara, and gone home to heaven, and that's a blessing.
Hallelujah.
But for those of us left behind, they will be greatly missed.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So we will be sharing a little bit more about that, and I'm excited to have you come back and join us. I hope you enjoy getting to know my guests just a little bit better. Thank you so much, and we'll see you in a little bit.
You're watching Amador County's local television network, TSPN.
And welcome back to Authors, Writers, Books, and Beyond. Again, I'm Kathy, and this is Kelly and Marcia and Patrick. And we're going to go to Kelly first and ask her to share a little bit about her new book.
Gladly.
Yay!
It's my debut novel. It's called A Bride Opens Shop in El Dorado, California. Mm. And the reason I set it in El Dorado, California is I am enamored with the Gold Country, and I, you know, really wanted to write that. It's a Christian historical romance from Barber Publishing. It came out this past summer. Mm.
Congratulations.
Thank you. It's exciting, as you know. Mm-hmm. The story is about a willful widow who comes west, hoping to become partner in a mercantile, but then she meets the mulish mercantile owner who doesn't know she's a woman and rejects her. So she decides she'll open a shop across the street from his.
Good for her.
What competition.
Yeah. And then there's more competition throughout the story. They compete in different areas.
So she's a very strong woman.
Very strong-willed woman, yes, definitely. And she has a 9-year-old daughter who people have told me is a lot of fun.
That's great.
Yeah, and the book is available at all the major booksellers, Amazon, Barnes & Noble, you know, online. It's both print and ebook.
It is ebook, too. Mm-hmm. Did that come out simultaneously?
It did, yes. Okay. Barbara puts them out simultaneously.
That's
now.
Nice. Mm-hmm. I'm curious, do you know which is selling better?
It depends on which day you look at Amazon.
Wow, that's interesting. Quite interesting.
Yeah.
And you have...
I've written more.
You've written more. I was wondering influenced you. Was there any particular...
Oh, about the story? Mm-hmm. There is, in the town of El Dorado, historically, there was a man named James B. Weatherwax who owned a mercantile. It was the most impressive store in town. He was very well liked. He was, you know, had a lot of properties. I used him as the model of the mercantile owner. And then for the heroine, I know that in California, unlike many other places in the nation, in 1870, women could already own businesses in their own name. We have the Immigrant Jane store in Placerville, California. Mm-hmm. And I modeled my heroine after, you know, that idea.
So she'd have her own.
Oh, I love doing the research. It's so fun.
Do we all agree that's a lot of fun?
Research is good.
Yeah, it's work, but fun work, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Well, Marcia, would you like to share a little bit about your book?
Well, essentially, I have an ebook that is out there right now. But I think I'd like to go back to you mentioning Ethel before.
Yes.
And this ebook is currently a reflection of a project that Ethel and I were working on together before she went home to be with the Lord last October. And essentially, we were planning to do a seminar in which we would invite Christian writers mm-hmm. to come, and we would equip them for leading a 40-day prayer ministry mm-hmm. for people who are seriously ill. And Ethel, because of her, at that point in time, four-year struggle with cancer, and a personal relationship that I have with a very dear friend who was told that she was terminal last January, and my experience with leading a prayer and fasting group for 40 mm-hmm. days with her, Ethel was really excited about that. Mm-hmm. And she and I were pooling resources, and one of them was to do a seminar, and the other one was to create a website. And essentially the purpose of both the ebook and the website is to help encourage writers to use their writing ability to minister to people who are seriously ill. And the way that we do that is instead of, let me back up. Typically what happens when somebody is seriously mm-hmm. ill, we in the Christian community are really great at bringing meals or offering to help with transportation or child care, whatever the practical helps may be, and there's obviously a lot of them. But ultimately, people need prayer as much as they need a daily meal. Mm-hmm. But the job of letting people know what your prayer requests are and how things are changing, all of that really generally falls on the person who is ill or their caregiver. Well, that job of the caregiver or just being ill can be all-consuming in and of itself. And so we really wanted to equip people around, you know, a friend or a family member who is not involved with daily care but can actually cultivate prayer for them within their own community. So that's basically so.
Huge help.
Yeah. So anyway, so the ebook, which relates to the website, which is prayerbook40.org, is just like every ebook title, how to cultivate a 40-day prayer community for a friend who's seriously ill. Mm-hmm. So
wonderful, wonderful ministry.
Thank you.
And that is really Ethel's legacy she leaves yeah. behind for us, was her prayer ministry.
Absolutely.
And Mount Hermon specifically, I know when I first went, she led the prayer meetings. Karen wow. Ball, I think, leads mm-hmm. them now, but mm-hmm. That's how I met Ethel Hare, was in prayer.
Wow.
So I that's a wonderful and needed ministry.
Yes.
That's when families are stretched their thinnest.
Yeah.
And not just faith put to the test, but you are physically white. Mm-hmm. And even just to have someone come alongside of you and pray with you.
Yeah.
Is a blessing. So I would be, how can people that aren't familiar with mm-hmm. your website, word of mouth, have you word of mouth gotten this out in other ways? Do you have a...
Yeah, well, actually the website just got up.
Oh, okay, good.
In the end of January.
What is it again?
It's called prayerbook40.org. And what's kind of bittersweet about the website is when Ethel and I connected up with one another, I originally was planning to do the website specifically to attract people who would be leaders of prayer of these 40-day prayer ministries. But Ethel has such an ability to encourage other people. And so part of the website is for attracting leaders. The other part is called Encouragement from a Sufferer. And that was really specifically built for Ethel. And she was going to write as a person who suffers, her encouragement to other sufferers and just the body of Christ. Mm-hmm. And so part of going to Mount Hermon for me this year, because I really, after the Lord took her home, I thought, should I leave that there? Should I take it down or not? And I decided, nope, Ethel's not the only person who has suffered, you know, serious illness and seen the Lord and lived out the Lord's faithfulness in a yeah. tangible way. There's many people Lots. Who have stories like this to share. And so anyway, so that part of the website, it's, you know, it's just a brand new site. There's lots and lots
Great.
Of stuff to add to it. But
Thank
anyway.
You.
Yeah.
And Patrick, I know you said you'll be writing two more in this series.
I've just sent the second one to Harvest House.
Congratulations.
It's called The Road Home. And it's actually the continuing story of one of the characters in this book.
Wonderful.
Second generation, mm-hmm. as it were. And it's been through its editing. Nick just finished editing, and now it's like disappearing into the publishing mill. And they've sent me things. Now you've got to send me the picture ideas for the cover for the third book. And so it's just kind of moving right along, really a lot faster than, you know, like all of a sudden I'm behind, you know.
He's such an amazing editor, too.
He's a tremendous editor. And I think the first person that I really connected with at Mount Hermon was Nick Harrison. And we were having a talk, and I have a background as a worship leader, and we were talking about worship. And I taught seminars for years about worship and using the model of the tabernacle of Moses as, you know, to enter into the Holy of Holies. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that I also taught was ensemble playing for young musicians and for young worship leaders. And one of the things that I teach them is that the most dangerous 6 inches in the world is that step up onto the platform. And Nick said, I'm going to pinch that. I want to use that. And you know, and so after that, we would always meet. And it just wasn't really until about 4 years later, I kept going and going. So 2007, 2008, 2009, and then in 2010, it all came together. So it's persistence and all that, but it's just been a wonderful ride since then.
Wow. Real nice.
You bring up such an amazing point, because the connections that we make at Mount Hermon are phenomenal.
Mm-hmm. Right.
They really are. Mm-hmm. To this day, from that very first time, Jerry Jenkins, I would call him an encourager. Mm-hmm. He sent me the first manuscript for Left Behind.
Wow.
I still have it up in my closet.
Wow.
And asked me to read it and tell him what he thought. And I thought, okay.
As soon as I come down, I will.
That's basically it. And you know, you sit with them at lunch and dinner, and I sat at his table, and what did we do? We whipped out our wallets, and we were showing pictures of our kids and our spouses. And, you know, that stayed. And I asked him to pray for my family. He and his wife pray for my son that's a soldier. So it's sitting at the lunch and dinner table with them was intimidating a little at first, but they are just people like us.
Yeah.
And I've never once, I've gone I think 5 or 6 times, run into an attitude. You know, there's just a real, a common spirit of humility and of respect in working together. There's teachers, there's encouragers, you know, every part of the body.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of iron sharpening iron, and I've learned so much there.
Mm-hmm.
I look forward to the lunches and dinners now, where before I was kind of afraid.
Yeah.
So you have to face fears too. You have to step out of your comfort zone.
Yeah. And the thing that's wonderful about the folks that teach there, the authors and the agents and all those folks, is that they spend hours and hours and hours until they're exhausted, working with people and going out of their way and meeting with people and encouraging them and giving them tips. And if they have something good, just saying, yeah, I want to see that. And if they need a little work, they're very good about just shepherding them. It's like I remember talking with Steve Lauby about that and saying, you know, I really appreciate all the blessing that you are to us. And he said, you know, it's a ministry for us. To come
that's
here.
Wonderful. You can really sense that.
And they really are shepherds. That's a perfect word, shepherding.
Mm-hmm.
They do an amazing job of opening their hearts and sharing their talents. And I don't think anyone leaves there the same.
No.
Mm-mm. I think we're changed for the better. And it's good to go back and hone your skills a little more each time. Before we go into break, would like to encourage you to come back and hear a little bit more about some of the specific mentors there and the involvement they've had in our life and what you can find there if you try it. Thank you very much, and we'll see you when you come back.
You're watching Amador County's local television network, TSPN.
Hi, welcome back. Thank you for joining us again. My name is Kathy, and if you're just coming in, this is Authors, Writers, Books, and Beyond, and I have guests today sharing about the Mount Hermon Christian Writers Conference. You've missed a little, but I'm sure you can glean something if you stay with us for a while. I have a local group of writers I founded here, Amateur Fiction Writers, that meets in Ione at Clark's Corner. Wonderful greeting place. We hold an annual read there. They serve food, specialty coffees. It's just a wonderful environment for not just writers. And they hold wonderful community events there that I think if you haven't gone, you ought to give them a try. They have new dinners coming up and serve, I don't know, prime rib and...
Yum.
Yeah, it's very good.
What's the address?
12 West Main Street, I am, California. I'm sure you will find it a wonderful venue. They have music and all art shows and encouragement for creative community activities and totally encourage family activities. Mm-hmm. And also on the literary and arts bench. So that's where my local group holds some of our meetings. And getting into that aspect of writing again, I'd like Patrick to tell us a little about his book, A Quilt for Jenna.
This is an interesting story. Jerusha is a master quilter. And this story is set in 1950, and she has lost her baby a year before. And so she has made this quilt. It's the most beautiful quilt that anyone has ever seen. And she's going to use the quilt as her ticket out of the Amish community. She is angry with God.
Wow. Okay.
And especially angry with her husband. Now, her husband is an interesting story because in World War II, he was a kind of almost Amish guy. He grew up Amish, but he rejected the teachings and wasn't baptized and, in fact, joined the Marines with his friend. And went to war and fought at Guadalcanal.
Wow.
And at Guadalcanal, he wins the Congressional Medal of Honor.
Wow.
But he wins it by killing Japanese soldiers in hand-to-hand combat.
Mm-hmm.
And it freaks him out. Mm-hmm. So he decides, I'm going back to the church, I'm going to keep the rules, and if I just keep the rules, I'll be okay with God.
Wow. Okay.
Well, so he becomes a stone legalist.
Oh.
And that's what contributes to the death of their daughter, because he won't take her to the hospital and she dies from bacterial meningitis. So he's gone. Jerusha is going up to the quilt fair in Dalton, and she's going to win first prize. On the way there, she gets caught in what has been described as the storm of the century. Came through Ohio in 1950 and dumped 30 feet of snow all the way from Pennsylvania into Indiana. She gets trapped in the storm. The car she's being driven in crashes. The driver goes for help. He gets hurt. He can't tell anybody where Jerusha is. So she's lost in the storm. She knows she's got to get to safety. So she starts walking through the snow to a cabin that's not far from where she is. And on the way, she finds another wrecked car. And in the wrecked car is a little girl, the same age as her daughter.
Aww.
Jerusha has to make a choice. If she has to save the little girl, the only way that she can save the little girl is to wrap her in the quilt.
Mm-hmm.
And that's going to ruin the quilt.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the story.
Oh, lovely.
Lovely. Wow.
What a great concept. And you had to research quilts because you said you didn't know about quilts.
Well, it was funny because as I was writing the book, I would write something and then I'd Google and I'd say, do the Amish... and I had to do a whole thing on quilting. The whole first chapter describes her making this quilt. Mm-hmm. And so I had to spend like about 3 weeks just going through books on quilting and how do you do it and what's the frame. Mm-hmm. And
some hands-on experience.
Yeah.
Ever stitched a stitch.
Stitched a stitch.
But so that's the story. And then in the second book, it's the ongoing story of the little girl that she found in the storm.
Oh, okay. Good.
Lovely.
Like to learn more about her.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to go to Marcia now and ask you to share a little bit more about the 40 days of prayer and fasting. As I understand it, it's not just for terminally ill. And I spoke on the phone about a private experience in my life that I just felt it was such a beautiful ministry that maybe, and I know Kelly has something she'd like to share. You could just expand a little more on that.
Sure. It is a ministry for anybody in the body of Christ, but it doesn't even have to be limited to Christians.
Right.
It's actually, frankly, a wonderful opportunity for someone who is a believer, who has a friend who's a non-believer, let's say, but is facing any form of, serious illness. You can ask them, would you like me to organize a prayer community for you out of the friends and family that you know of that pray? Mm-hmm. And I think there would be very few unbelievers who would say no to that. But Kelly, during the break, you were telling me a little bit about a personal experience
that
you
had.
That
was my mother-in-law.
Okay.
Yeah, we were going through, you know, her death of cancer, and mm-hmm. I was the family member who was disseminating information and trying to, you know, keep my mother-in-law and my father-in-law from having to deal with all of that. I really could have used a resource like this.
Yeah.
They're just, you know, there's not anything out there like that.
Yeah.
So I think what you're doing is going to be very beneficial mm-hmm. to people.
Yeah.
Thank you. A great need out there, I think, globally, not just regionally or nationally, but I think it's global.
Mm-hmm. Well, and one of the amazing things is that through this, because it's all done through email, you can link together people in a prayer community around somebody who loves, who, you know, the person who is ill is loved by people undoubtedly across the United States. That actually the first prayer community that was started a year ago, there are people on her prayer in who pray for Lana in Kenya.
Yeah.
And so we have this community that truly reaches across the mm-hmm. globe, and it's built around the suffering of someone that they all love. And one of the sort of serendipitous things that happened through this was that the goal was to provide prayer and support for the person who's sick. But what has come out of this is not only does that happen, but the community around that person, they're suffering too. Kelly,
oh, yes.
You are suffering, the whole family. And everyone who loves that person is right. suffering. And to be linked together, to be joined together in a prayer community, the whole community is blessed and built up right. and encouraged and given strength. And it's like Lana, the first prayer recipient of this, she said, I have never experienced the church like I have experienced it through these. She has like about 40 people on her prayer team who pray for her. And it's been phenomenal what the Lord has done.
I was a pastor for many years, and one of the things that kind of put me off my feed was that the church did not do this.
Yeah.
What the church, where it's really has fallen down, is in expressing the genuine love of Christ.
Yeah.
That's what people want. Mm-hmm. Unbelievers, anybody.
Anybody.
You can give them the real love of Christ, they will respond to it. Mm-hmm. They don't want a program.
No.
They don't want loud music. They don't want all that. That's not what they're looking for.
Stuff.
They're looking to be touched in their spirit and their heart.
Yeah.
It's such a great, great project.
It really is. And it's,
thank you.
Prayer is, I think, the most powerful weapon and gift we have here on earth. And we're not using it within the church, I think, as we're called to.
Mm-hmm.
I think that you are going to find a more overwhelming response now that you're just getting out there than you may even anticipate. Mm-hmm. I am respectful when I ask someone, may I pray for you?
Mm-hmm.
Not one person has ever turned me down.
Yeah.
Very few people will say, no, don't pray for me.
Right.
I mean, it has never happened yet.
Yeah.
And I hope that in some way this show gives you a little bit more exposure to get the word out there. Because there's a great need. It's a deep felt need that I think the church is being called to rise up to again.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
Well, there's a great statement by Donald Gray Barnhouse, who was a teacher back in the 30s. And he said this: the church was not left in the world to perfume the dung heap of fallen humanity,
amen,
but to take out one by one those who will be saved from the coming destruction.
Mm-hmm.
It's such a great point of view.
Wow. Mm-hmm. And what greater time than when we're at our worst physically, mm-hmm, near death or dying, mm-hmm, that is when the need is the greatest. Not
that's
just
right
for this person that's sick, as you point out, but the family, the daughter-in-law, the husband, mm-hmm, the wife.
It's when the need is greatest, but it's also, honestly, what I've learned through this is if you're given a diagnosis of terminal and you've walked with the Lord for a number of years, it's actually a gift to know that your days truly are numbered, because we're all terminal.
Mm-hmm.
But
mm-hmm,
we don't live in the light of that reality.
That's true.
And when you have something like a
very serious, incurable condition, it crystallizes mm-hmm. everything that matters most in life. And to share, to be given the privilege to walk with somebody who has had an experience that is brought to bear what are those most important things, it is a gift, an absolute gift to walk with them through that.
Yes. I couldn't agree with you more. I think we are all in agreement mm-hmm. in that. And it's a very deep subject.
It is.
It is a very... Mm-hmm. It's the heart of Christ. If he himself came, he comes to us through suffering. The prayers and touch right. of others mm-hmm. in our suffering. Mm-hmm. We're never alone. Mm-hmm. And I can't help it. I can see Ethel's face, mm-hmm. and as she suffered at the end with cancer, I got to sit with her last year at the book signing.
Oh, wonderful.
And just to be near her, because she was my big prayer encourager, yeah. prayers are deathless. They live beyond the death
Absolutely.
Of the human being.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know what greater ministry you can put your time into than that itself. Mm-hmm. And we'll come back in a little bit and talk about a few more things involving our books and each other, a little bit more sharing. And I'd like to show Ethel's book. And then we'll be back and I'll talk to you about it a little bit more. Thank you, and we look forward to seeing you in a little bit.
You're watching Amador County's local television network, TSPN.
Hi, welcome back. I'm glad you could join us. I'm going to talk a little bit about the bookstore next door, Hein & Company. They have gone through something of a metamorphosis recently and offer a lot more than they used to. Wolf, Linda, Eric, and Brian do a wonderful job. You can buy just about any book in creation. They have trunks and vintage they're carrying now. Just an amazing selection of gifts and antiquities, and including antique books. You can get calendars, cards, CDs, even VHS that's old. They have a new steampunk section I'm not familiar with. They have an upstairs section that will be called, yeah, it's a little different. I'm not familiar with that.
Yeah, right.
Sherlock Holmes section they're building upstairs. Well, they'll be hosting readings and murder mysteries and antique clothes, because they work a lot with the local theater, Volcano Theater, and you can have writers' workshops there and many, many functions. It's right next door here to where we are today. So again, welcome back, and I'm going to go right back to where I was talking about Ethel Hur's book, An Introduction to Christian Writing. This is the first book I bought at Mount Hermon. Mm-hmm. I recommend it to everybody. It's had a couple revisions. It's a gold mine for a beginning writer. I would have been lost without it. And her heart and soul, and I know this book was prayed over before it was written, mm-hmm. Helped me come out of the I want to be a writer stage to becoming a writer, going through that journey. Mm-hmm. And so I've also brought another book, Sean Grady's. These are some books. He went through Mount Hermon and was published through the conference there. Right. And I actually took copies of this up to the local Cal Fire Academy where they train the fire students, and was blessed to go to his first launch up in Reno. Mm-hmm. So, and he's just a wonderful guy that is another product like Patrick. And
Great guy.
Yeah, he really is. Just a sweetheart. He has mm-hmm. a lovely wife and family. And these are wonderful stories. These are mysteries. So a little different than Patrick's. You get a lot of variety. Mount Hermon will reach out to, you can write in any genre. They have a new teen track that is just amazing. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they have songwriting there for the writers' conference. They offer a very big variety. It's not just fiction and nonfiction. You are able to pick the poetry. I think someone mentioned Angela. Was that you, mm-hmm. Angela Elwell Hunt? I took a fiction workshop from her, a major morning one that was just phenomenal. As a matter of fact, real quick, I'm going to share. For a writer, this has stuck with me since then. She had us all, whoever was brave enough, scribble down your opening sentence of your novel.
Yes. Uh-huh.
And take it up, and then she read them. And then she would say, eh, or mmm. And it was, no one knew, it was anonymous. And you sat there and listened, and your heart was pitter-patting until yours was read too. But boy, what a great education to sit there with other writers, and you could really tell which ones had it and which ones had no effect whatsoever, and you really needed to go back and work on it again. So, and that one little thing was phenomenal.
In my critique group yesterday, we were starting a brand new book, and I specifically mentioned, I went to their first, I read the first sentence in the person's book, and I said, and I talked about the Angela Hunt's workshop, and I said, this would have been down here. But then I went several, you know, ways into the book, and I read this other sentence from her book, and I said, if you started your book right here, and I read the sentence, and the expression was, I can see. So,
and usually she's right. We begin our books down here. Yeah. You've got all this other stuff on top, and really your opening is a little lower.
I started the second book in this series with the character saying an Amish swear word.
Oh,
means
I didn't know they had those.
They do. I mean, it didn't mean anything bad. It just means you so and so.
Oh, okay.
But her mother busts her right away.
Well, and I think we've all too really enjoyed, Patrick and I were talking about Dave Talbot's amazing talent. He plays the music there that is just phenomenal. In the worship, is so worshipful.
Yeah.
And he's such a gifted man.
The Palm Sunday service is just
moving.
It is deeply moving.
Mm-hmm. He's a magnificent keyboardist. Mm-hmm. You'll never hear anybody play the organ or the piano like Dave plays it. Some people may think he has an old-fashioned style, but that's me.
I love it.
I love what he does, and it's always inspiring to me. And he always picks songs that present the gospel. Mm-hmm. And there's a real dearth of that in the church today. We need the gospel.
Mm-hmm. Yes, we
need to hear the gospel. Mm-hmm. That's wherein we stand, as Paul said in Corinthians. Yeah.
So. And those old hymns are full of it. They are little stories that tell about the suffering of Christ and the need for repentance and of redemption and hope. So, and he's just so gifted. And Rachel, and talk about prayer, Rachel and Rod, we've all been praying for Roger Williams, going through an amazing cancer journey. And I'm on their prayer list. And you just, it's a gift to pray for someone else.
It is.
It's a gift that changes you, and it should change us, because you're putting someone else before you. You are interceding, not just putting the other person before you, but you are taking time out of your own life to put something, I think.
It's sacrificial.
Right. It is a sacrificial act. That's the word I was looking for. I'm going to go back to Kelly, and we're going to be winding down. Is there something you'd like to share?
Well, I'd like to tell everyone that I have a website.
Yay.
I actually call it my Victorian cyber home.
Ooh.
It has a parlor and a study and a library. And it is kellygwynn.com.
And Kelly, you should mention how your name is spelt.
It is very different. My mother didn't want it to look like a boy's name, so it's K-E-1-L-I. Mm-hmm. And the last name, I got it from my wonderful Welshman husband, is Gwyn, G like girl, W-Y-N.
Right.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And Patrick and Marcia, real quick before we go, could you share something else about your